Hello, buddy. Welcome to another episode of Basement Electronics. Today we're going to dip back into the most complete starter kit for the Arduino that was given to me by Elegoo, and we're going to make a temperature controlled fan. Here are the parts we're going to need to work on our project today. So we have, of course, Arduino. We have a power supply module that came with the kit. And this is kind of neat because this fits onto your power rails of your breadboard. And each of these power rails are independent and you can control them as either 5 volt or 3.3. So I'm going to turn off this upper rail because we're not going to use that today. We're going to set this bottom rail for 5 volts. And then right now this power switch is turned off. We have our DC motor with a nice little propeller, which will be useful for making a fan. We have our motor control chip. We've seen this before in the robotic car. We have our DHT11 sensor, so our humidity and temperature sensor. Of course, some wires. And then power supply to run the power board. So I'm going to start by putting together the motor control, and we're going to see how that works first. Because when you have a multi-part project like this, it's usually best to start one part at a time and then fit them together as you go. So let's start with seeing how the motor works. Here we go, all wired up. The motor and the Arduino hooked up through the controller chip. Right now I have the power supply board turned off so that we don't supply power to the fan right away, so we can control the Arduino. So we're back in the part 2 learning module that came with the starter kit. And we're going to 2.23 DC motors. In the PDF that comes with it, they have a slight description on how to use the power supply module, how the controller chip works to control up to 2 motors, and then the wiring diagram. And this is the wiring that I used for our current setup here. This clip is just to keep the fan up so that when it spins, it doesn't hit the mat. With this lesson, we have our DC motor.ino, and we're just gonna load that up into our Arduino IDE. So our pin 5 is our enable pin. This is what turns the motor on, and by supplying a pulse width modulated signal to it, you can control the speed. And then pins 3 and 4 are your direction pins. So only one of these pins would be high at any given time, and then depending which pin is in high state would determine what direction the fan is spinning. In the loop, we have our example. So we have so we're enabling the pin, we're setting it directions. As you can see, as you go further down, we try different speeds. So let's write this into our Uno and watch the demonstration. So you'll notice that even though it thinks it's doing work, nothing's running yet. That's because we haven't turned on the power module yet. So there we go. So this is working with our motor. Now let's hook up our DHT module and see how this one works, and then we'll get the two working together. Hooking up the DHT wasn't very complicated because it was only the 3 wires, so I decided to hook it up just beside the existing circuits for the motor. One of the things you notice is that I'm using the power and ground rails in order to handle the power for the board. The ground is all a common ground. As you can see, the Arduino is plugged into it too, so you should do that anyway. But the power supplied by the module, by the power supply module, is going to be a lot more stable than the power coming from the Arduino. This is especially true the more that you want to control from your controller board. Whenever you're handling sensors or especially things that may be high power like a motor, you'll always want to use an external power supply and not rely on the power coming out of your controller board. This is only for very low current. Like if you just have like a single sensor, or you're just doing a quick check, sure, use your onboard power, but try to avoid using your onboard power. So going back to the learning modules from the starter kit, we're going to be using 2.11, and we'll load up the PDF. And in the PDF, they tell you about how the sensor works and the accuracies. Now, one of the things I like about this DHT module that comes in the kit is they mounted it on a separate PCB, and then the PCB itself only has the three pins coming out. Whereas anyone who's worked with these modules before, like just the DHT modules, knows that there's four pins that come out. And one of the pins is a dead non-connection pin. Whenever I work with these, I'm always looking up to try to remember which one is the pin with no connection. Having the module like this certainly takes a lot of the confusion out of it. So down here, that's how we have it hooked up into the digital pin 2. Here they talk about the code. Now, one of the things they did different than you would see in your traditional DHT example for the Arduino is that they use a non-blocking library. Now, what that means is the program will be getting the values from your temperature humidity module in the background, and then you're just basically fetching the values out of memory whenever you need it. So you don't have to, so in your program, you're not waiting for your program to call the module, wait for the timing to come back with your values, then calculate and then return the value, because that can slow down the response of your circuit. But it does mean that you have to install a custom library in your Arduino's libraries folder. Now, in the example directory, you'll see there's a dht.zip. In that zip file is your non-blocking library, and they're nice enough to give you an example, which is probably pretty much the same thing that we're using in our example. And then all you need to do, like I'm just holding my right mouse button down, dragging it over to my libraries, then extract. And then that would extract it into the DHT folder. Now I'm not going to do it because I've already done it and the library is already here. Pull up our DHT example. So we're including our library. We have a couple constants defined for the type of module and the pin. And then here we're creating our non-blocking object. In the setup, we're just declaring our serial connection. We have a static function that this is what handles grabbing the temperature and humidity from the memory from your object that's running in the background. Then in your loop, you're redefining your temperature and humidity values, calling your function, and then you're sending these values as pointers into the function, then you're printing out the values. You'll see that it's now spitting out the temperature and humidity from the DHT module. Let's use the code from these two examples in order to drive our motor. And again, this code can be found through the GitHub link down in the description. And all I did was combine the two programs. In the setup, we're setting our default state for our motor. These direction values, these shouldn't change through the program because we're not going to be pulling air. We just want to push the air from the fan to cool whatever it is we want to cool. In our loop, I'm still declaring the temperature and humidity because the function uses the temperature and humidity pointers, and I really didn't feel like rewriting it to not use the humidity, so it's here. If the temperature goes over 29 degrees Celsius, turn the fan on. Also, do a test. If the fan is not already on, print a line on our serial, and then set our fan flag to true. Otherwise, if the temperature is not over 29 degrees, turn the fan off, and then if the fan flag is already turned on, print the status to our serial, and then set our flag off. And then we just, again, print our temperature and humidity values to our serial. Let's clear the output just so we can know for sure. You'll see it's grabbing temperature and humidity again, just like the DHT example. I'll put my thumb over the DHT to try to warm it up a bit. So humidity's going up, that's not surprising. And hit 30 degrees, so the fan turned on and told us in the serial. So why don't we use this fan, try to cool off our sensor. So you can see the humidity going down again. Mind you, I've managed to get up to 31, so this might take a second. There. Went below 30 degrees, so turn the fan off. And that's how you make a temperature-controlled fan. Now, I have some additional ideas of things I want to do with this, but I'm going to save those for a future video. In the meantime, let's call this here. I hope you found this interesting, if not informative. And we'll see you next time. Goodbye.